little bit about my personal experience as a pioneer. And I also talk a little about developing a network or building a community. This is a slide I told you a little bit about last time, but if you were not here, maybe I can do it in a quick way so you know what I'm talking about. When we start a Pioneer's Place, we always start with listening to God, to the context, to the team, and to the local church. What's the local situation? Are there more churches? Are there a lot of young people living, or is it more like an old people community? What are other churches already doing? What is God saying in this situation? And that leads to loving and serving. So what do the people tell they need, and how can we be of importance as a church to the local community? That can be a lot of different things. So you can do some sports together, or you can have a food bank or something with art. It doesn't matter what you do, but it's important that it's something people locally say, they think it's interesting and they need it. And we hope when we organize activities, relationships will follow and a network will develop. I'll tell you more about that later. And from that network, when you get to know people, some people want to explore discipleship. So what does it mean to be a Christian? You're part of a church, but you're so normal. Tell me more about it. What does being a Christian mean for you as a person? And when they know you, these questions will appear a little bit faster, I think. And we hope a church will take shape. And we have experienced that for a church to take shape, that it will take 7 to 12 years to mature. This is about the third circle, developing a network. I will start there and also talk a little bit about the next two circles. So exploring discipleship and church taking shape. The definition, it's a network of people who have multiple personal relations, who are regularly at activities, and who see themselves as participants of a recognizable group. So that's a mouthful of words. But it's also important you see three things, multiple personal relations. So it usually starts with relationships from people from the community with people of the Pioneers team. But we also hope that they get connected to each other. So not just with the team, but also as a community, they get to know each other and personal relationships will evolve and grow. And the second thing is that, it's important that they come together on a regular basis. So you can say at least once a month, if you want to be part of a community, you have to meet, you have to get to know people. And if you don't see each other very often, then that's really hard. And the last thing is that people have to see themselves as part of the recognizable group. So sometimes we think people are part of our group because they visit an activity, but it's important that they see themselves as participants of recognizable group. What's not necessary for developing a network? Membership, sharing faith, and big numbers. So I'm talking about the third circle. So in that phase of pioneering, it's not necessary to talk about faith. People don't have to be a member of the group. They just can come and go home, and sometimes they disappear in a while, and sometimes they become a part of the network, of the community. And it doesn't have to be a big group of people. You can start with a small group, maybe with one activity or one thing you do together. It has to be big. I told you something about the network. It usually starts with the Pioneers team. You see four dots here. That's the Pioneers team visualized. And I think two things are important if you start pioneering with the Pioneers team. If you have fun together, people will see that and they want to join. If you're fighting among each other, then you're not very attractional and people will join another group. They will play soccer or they go to do another course. So you have to have a nice ambience or atmosphere to be attractional. And it's also important to be united in vision. So that as a group, where do you want to go? And if you are united, people will notice that. But you still see the Pioneers team here in the middle, but other relationships, they appear. So the team gets connected with people in the community. The network is expanding. But what we hope is that the people from the community also get connected with each other, so that this network will grow and new relationships will grow. I tell you something about my story, because that's what you asked of me, and I think it's really helpful. It can be really helpful. I translated this presentation in English. Some words are Dutch because there's no translation for it, but I think you can follow me. In the first picture, you see a house. That's a really Dutch house. And that was our location where we started the Pioneers Place. And this was a new housing estate in a city where 100,000 people lived. And in this new housing estate, 25,000 people were going to live there. So that was 1/5 of the city. It's Zoetermeer. Zoet means sweet. So we sometimes say the translation in English is Sweet Lake City. But so it's a really big city in the Dutch context of 125,000 people. And we rented the house in that area because there was no church. And when I came there, that was in 2008, the Pioneers Place already started. They started in 2001 and they had some activities for adults and for kids. There was a kids club and they had a Rock Solid group. I don't know if that's a thing in Wales too, but that's a teenage group. And they come together and play a lot of crazy games with whipped cream and a lot of mess. And also they talk about a Bible story every evening. And so the name of our teenage group was Rock Solid. And we had four teenagers. And three of them already were part of a church. So only one was from outside the church. And that's the situation when I started. And my job was to focus on children with their parents and on teenagers, and to make it possible to get connected, get involved in our community from the age of 4 until they became adults. So a lot of work has to be done because we only have a children's group, 4 to 12 years, I think, or 4 to 10 it was, and 4 teenagers. But the question I asked myself when I started organizing activities, it always was, how does this activity build the community? How does it stimulate the network? And you can do that. You can ask yourself that question about every activity you organize. If the answer is, this doesn't build our network or our community, maybe you have to ask another question. Is it possible to change the activity so it does build up our community or our network, or maybe we don't have to organize this activity anymore. So you can focus on what's really helping in developing the Pioneers Place. And sometimes you have to make choices and don't do things anymore. But if you look at this activity, we had four teenagers. And what we tried to do is, okay, how can we build this community? We started with a welcome at the door, because that's the first moment you have a connection with the teenagers. You see them, you can ask them, how was your week? What's going on? Oh yeah, brought a new friend. So that's the first connection. And that's, I think, really important. This activity was in the house you saw, and we had three floors. You can choose to organize an activity in one room. But when the group started growing, we started, we tried to do the activities in smaller groups. So on every floor, we had one group, and there was a circulation. So if you started on the top floor, then you went to the middle floor, and then to the, the lowest floor. And you had groups of maybe 4, 5, 6 people. And when you work in smaller groups, it's easier to build a community, to get to know people. And teenagers, they can be really loud. They can be really intense. And also for the volunteers, it's easier to coordinate a group of 6 teenagers than a group of 15. And it's also possible to make different groups, that you say, if you have a brother and sister, you can separate them or keep them together. Sometimes you can make a girl group or a boy group. What we also did was open nights. So sometimes the kids from the teenagers from Rock Solid, they get to invite other people. They were always allowed to do that, but sometimes we make a thing of it. So it's an open night, and who can you invite for the next meeting? And what we also tried to do was get a connection with a kids club. So some of the children, they grew older, and the kids club ended for them. So how can we get the connection between the kids club and the Rock Solid club, so they can still be part of our community? And what we also tried to do was we made contracts, sometimes with the older teenagers. How can you participate in this activity? So we wanted to stop with organizing the activity for them, but do it together with them. And I made a contract with 10 different ways of being involved. You can think about I wanted them to choose one or two of those activities they would be feeling comfortable with. So sometimes their job was to invite other people. Sometimes it was to help set up the evening. So put down the chairs and the tables and the crazy games. Sometimes they helped with the cooking or stuff. So they all have different jobs, and they signed it. And so they were really a serious part of the organization. And that helps them also to grow in leadership. So sometimes one of the teenagers, they became older, and they led one activity together with a senior leader. And because we had 3 different rounds, 3 different groups, and they were circulating, the first time the senior leader could explain how to do the activity. The second time they could do it together. And the third time the teenager could do it himself or herself. So that was a way to get them involved and also to grow in leadership. And after a few years, you saw that some activities were totally organized by local people, and sometimes also only young people around the age of 16, 17, 18. But that's just how to grow a community in one activity. But we tried to get this activity connected with other activities also organized for the same age group. And because the Rock Solid was only once a week, and we wanted them to give them an opportunity to see each other more often. So what we did was we started the cooking club. That was a course of 4 weeks and only 8 children could join. And what I did was I invited always two teenagers from the Rock Solid Club and 6 other teenagers from the neighborhood. And the course was 4 weeks and then it ended. And they said, oh, it was really nice time. We had a nice time. What else can we do? Can we do it again, the cooking club? Or are there other ways to get involved? And then the kids, the two who already joined Rock Solid, they said, oh yeah, on Monday there's Rock Solid. If you want, you can come too. So those little courses of 4 weeks, they gave us the possibility to get connected with other teenagers and also to try to get them involved in our weekly community. And we did a cooking class, cooking course 5 times a year. So we had a constant new group of teenagers who joined our network. And here are some other activities we also did. The teenage tent week, that was a 1 week in the summer. We rented the tent outside and we had a sports events week with a lot of different activities. And we tried to connect that week also with our weekly activity. And we also had a Christmas dinner show where the teenagers, they did everything. So they did a presentation, they did a musical, and also 3 courses of dinner where they invited their families to. So with the Christmas dinner show and also with the cooking club, we also got connected with the parents, because on the cooking club on the 4th evening, the kids, the teenagers, they cooked for their parents. So they all invited 2 guests. So we had 8 teenagers and 16 guests together in one room. And so the parents could also see, it's a nice community to be a part of. They're not that weird. They started to trust us with their children. So we tried to get this activity, our weekly community, connected with other activities where we try to meet with new teenagers to expand our network. And all those activities were not especially about faith. Rock Solid is, but the other 3 activities, they were not. Maybe the 10th week a little bit, but also, but after a while, we saw that a few of the teenagers, they grew older and they started to ask questions about faith. So we started the Youth Alpha and a youth, the growing group. This is a literal translation, but that's a weekly group about faith in a way that fits with the youth. So these activities, they started a little bit later. Maybe you can say that this is part of the circle exploring discipleship, but we didn't start with these activities. This started after a few years of Rock Solid, and after we've built we have grown our network. And then they started asking questions, and when they started to do that, we started to organize these activities. So we made it possible to explore discipleship. And what you see here is the bigger picture. The light blue circles, those were activities for children. The yellow ones are the activities for teenagers. And the darker blue ones are activities for the grown-up people, for the adults. And what we try to do is not organize more activities for one age group, but also get the age groups connected with each other. So to get a connection between the activities for children to the activities of the teenagers. And when the teenagers grew older, a few of them, when I've met them, they were 11, but when I left, they were 18. So they could also sometimes be part of the adult activities. So we try to organize connections. And after the project started in 2001, I came in 2008, and that was the same period that we started with church. We called it meetings, perron meetings. A perron is like a platform for the trains. It's a moment where you stand still during your traveling and you're waiting for the next train, next phase of life. And we called it like the platform meetings, a moment to be silent, to reflect before you go on. And in these meetings, we try to connect all these different activities in one group of people. And we did a lot of things to make that possible. Sometimes to ask a specific group of people who join a specific activity to organize the meeting. So sometimes we did a meeting organized by the teenagers. And they had a big part of the meeting. They did the presentation. They sometimes prepared games or the food and the talk. Usually I did that. But we also had VIP meetings. So sometimes a famous Christian from the city came to tell something about how do you be a Christian in this age, in your job, in your personal life. So we had different kind of meetings. We also have meetings where we ate together. We started with some program. Then we had part of the meal, then program. Then we had the main course, a little program, and then we had dessert. So people were sitting at tables, they got a meal, but also there was a meeting with a Bible story and prayer and sometimes singing. About this, the developing of a network takes time. What I showed you, the project is still there, but we are now in 2021. So it's there for 20 years. And the church is still growing. I think on a Sunday, about 70 or 80 people come together in the perron meetings, the platform meetings. To build a community is important in itself. It's not useless or a waste of time when it doesn't evolve into exploring discipleship or a church taking shape. It's also important to meet new people and to be there for them and to be visible as a church, to be part of the community. And how your networks will evolve, it also depends on the need of the people you try to reach out to. Some people really like to be part of a network, but also some people, they don't really like it. So you also have to check in what network they feel comfortable in. I think that's for now the first part of the presentation.